ESPN Sports. This is Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertsons Safeway.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to MTN's Grizzly Insider. I'm your host, Kyle Hansen. This past weekend saw the Montana Grizzlies go to Sacramento, California for a top 10 matchup with Sac State. And we'll be joined by Grizz head coach Bobby Houck to talk about that game, as well as look ahead to UM's upcoming game with Weber State. We'll also be joined by Grizz men's basketball coach Travis DeKeer to preview the upcoming season for Montana, a team with high expectations as basketball season is right around the corner. All of that is coming up, but we'll kick things off looking back at the highlights from Montana's contest with Sacramento State. The Montana Grizzlies entered the game number 7 in the FCS, but lost to Idaho last week and had lost 2 straight contests to the Hornets, a team ranked number 2 in the country. The game started off well for the Grizz, who used a 15-play drive to score the game's first points, as they became the first team this year to lead Sac State. But disaster and controversy struck in the second quarter, as UM quarterback Lucas Johnson was injured on a late hit targeting foul that took him out of the game. So Chris Brown entered the game at QB, and Montana held onto the lead as UM's defense forced a pair of turnovers in the second quarter to throw Sac State's league-leading offense off balance. Now down 10-0, Sac State found its way onto the board as Jake Dunaway found Marshall Martin for a 38-yard touchdown. Nico Ramos went 1-for-3 on field goals in the first half, including a blocked kick right before halftime, but UM still led 10-7. Montana's defense continued to play lights out as Nash Fouch picks off Dunaway for Montana's second interception of the game. Then later, Brown hit Aaron Fonts for a 16-yard touchdown, and just like that, Montana led 17-7. However, Sac State scored on the first play of the fourth quarter when Dunaway hit Pierre Williams to trim it to 17-14. But UM racked up 200 yards rushing, led mostly by Marcus Knight and Nick Osmo. And here's Osmo capping another long UM drive to make it 24-14 Grizz. Sac State got a break on another UM special team snafu as the kick bounced off of Tyler Flink and the Hornets recovered. Following that recovery, Sac State faced a 4th-and-4 on UM's 30, and it was arguably the most talked about play from the game, as Dunaway finds Jared Gibson along the sideline and it's ruled a catch, but it appears Gibson's foot is out of bounds before the catch was made. However, it's reviewed and confirmed by officials, and on the very next play, Asher O'Hara tied it 24-24. The game would go into overtime after neither team could score on their final drives of regulation. But the Hornets needed just 4 plays before O'Hara found the end zone again. Meanwhile, UM went 4 and out as the Hornets held on for their 3rd straight victory over the Grizz, 31-24. Up next, we have Grizz head coach Bobby Houck in studio to break down Montana's game against the Hornets. We'll be right back on Grizzly Insider.
There's more coverage of the Grizzlies online anytime at montanasports.com. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertsons Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, and we're both kind of, you know, operating on a couple hours of sleep here with head coach Bobby Houck. Bobby, how are you feeling? And, you know, just coming off another tough loss for you guys.
Yeah, you know, coming off of that game last night wasn't all that much fun in terms of the outcome. The game being played was enjoyable to be a part of, but 2 hours of sleep's not good for either one of us.
Right. I was about to say, coming off a long road trip, we're back here. But we're back here to, you know, chop it up a little bit about this game. And, you know, that you've had, not a ton of time to digest this one. Just kind of, you know, give me some of your thoughts of that you've got to think about it a little bit.
Well, yeah, we've had a couple hours to think about it. And you know, I'm really disappointed. I thought our team played really well in the game. I thought they played hard and physical. I thought that our assistant coaches had a nice game plan. That we executed it really well. You know, we're sitting here, we lost a week ago to a pretty good Idaho team, and then we went on the road and lost to the second-ranked team in America in a game that, you know, we really feel like we should have won. So that's disappointing, but there's some positives we can take out of it when we're moving forward this week.
You guys started the game so strong in that first offensive drive. I think it was about a 6-minute drive. You know, Lucas Johnson looks really good throwing the ball. He runs it a couple times, and you guys cap it off with the touchdown run to make it 7-0. First time Sac State has trailed all season long. And then, you know, later in the game, Lucas gets the targeting hit on him on the late hit, knocks him out of the game. Just, you know, my first question, I guess, is what did you like about your offense, the way you guys are running? And then, you know, when he goes out, how much did that kind of change things?
Well, I liked the way it was going. Lucas was playing great. Sac State had not even begun to think about stopping us at that point, I don't think. We were rolling up and down the field. And then, you know, you're never going to be real excited when your starting quarterback or any of your players gets knocked out on a late hit and a targeting foul. So that was a bad play. I was pleased with Chris Brown coming in and taking the reins and helping us score some points and keep the lead through the game.
It's such a pivotal play when he goes out and things like that. So as you guys, you know, are kind of on the fly adjusting, I guess, what is that process like? And obviously your thoughts probably go to him too, because it was a pretty scary play.
Yeah, first concerns for our guy. But we have a good medical staff, and they took good care of him, of course. Disappointed he was unable to return, certainly, because he was playing so well and the offense was rolling. But you prepare for that. There's a reason why that guy's the starter. So you prepare for it, and you temper your call sheet as best you can, but you got to go operate. And I thought our kids rose to the occasion. I was fired up about our players. The attitude's awesome. I just really like this team and how they approach things.
You, like you kind of touched on, Chris Brown played well in relief. You know, obviously you had some experience with that last year coming in and playing. You know, just what'd you like about the way he kind of helped run the offense? And, you know, really as the game progressed, they couldn't stop you guys running, and you guys really could control it on offense, it seemed like.
My sense is that the offensive line is really evolving and getting better. They're pretty young, but that's the best it's looked in maybe 4 years. So in terms of being able to kind of impose our will and run the ball the way we want to run it, those guys did a nice job. Our running backs ran hard. We were productive. We were good on defense. You know, again, we led the whole game. So it's really disappointing not to be able to close it out.
Last week against Idaho was interesting because, you know, the last couple of weeks, they've talked about the turnover battle and how you guys have kind of been on the tough end of that. But, I mean, your guys played so well. Corbin Walker had the interception in the second, Nash the interception in the third, and, you know, just kind of helped you guys keep that momentum, you know, in that element. So, you know, the defense coming up with big plays like that, what was like seeing that from them? Because, they seemed like they played really, really well.
We had we have smart guys in our defense, and we really kind of had two different game plans. For the two different quarterbacks they use, because the offenses are a little bit different and based on who's in the game. And I thought our defense gave them some things that they hadn't handled and hadn't seen. Had them confused a little bit, harassed them into some bad plays. So it was a good job. Just like I said, game like that, you know, you need one more play. I mean, literally one more play in any phase, and we get the job done there. And it's unfortunate we didn't. Pretty disappointed in that.
It's a game that ultimately came down to just some tough breaks, you know, whether it be some injuries, you know, some things that maybe didn't go your guys' way, you know, just in a game like that, you know, how do you, I guess, like, you know, what's it like being in that moment trying to kind of, you know, steer the ship forward when just, it just felt like everything was kind of going against you guys, against them?
Well, that's well said. Probably the way I should say it. Yeah, everything was working against us, certainly, late in the game, in particular in the fourth quarter. Our guys were composed. Everything that could go against us went against us. There are some things in the game that I think were, I don't know, probably not good enough by a lot of folks. So we need to finish it out.
Ultimately, you get to the overtime period, sack ultimately does tie it. And, you know, just what was kind of the message to the team then, and what were you guys kind of looking for on your offensive possession towards the end there?
Well, it's kind of like any point in the game. You go play the next play. You know, football games, there's going to be momentum swings, and it's going to go up and down and back and forth, especially when two good teams are playing. And so, you know, that's what it is. Go play the next play. You can't worry about the last one. You got to play the next play. Sometimes you don't do well, and you've got to go make a play on the next one. And that's part of being a competitor and closing games out.
Thanks so much, Coach. Yeah. Don't go anywhere right now. Coach will rejoin us here to look ahead to Weber State. We'll also be joined by head men's basketball coach Travis Tahir to preview the upcoming basketball season for the Montana Grizzlies.
Get social with Grizzly fans and follow MTN Sports on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider. And folks, basketball season is just about here, and I am joined by head men's basketball coach Travis Tahir to talk about the upcoming season for the Montana Grizzlies. Travis, it's great to see you.
Appreciate you having me.
Of course. I mean, hard to believe, basketball season, couple weeks away. You know, a lot of excitement around your team coming into this season. You want to just kind of walk us through what this year's Grizzly squad is going to look like for you guys?
Bigger, faster, stronger. You know, for us, really, it was addressing some of our weaknesses, rebounding, defending in the paint. So we went out and got some size and added some athleticism, but more importantly, experience.
It's interesting too, you know, bigger, stronger, you know, as I've been covering this team for about 5 years now, and by far this is the biggest team I think I've seen in my time here, watching you guys play. You know, just walk us through maybe some of these transfers that you brought in. You brought in, you know, a very skilled player in Deshaun Thomas from Colorado State. He's going to add a lot, and some of these other guys, you know, just kind of talk about what you've seen from them for your first few months of practice with these guys.
Yeah, versatility offensively from Deshaun I think is the biggest thing. You know, he's known for a three-point shooting. Obviously, that was his role at Colorado State. But as a young man that's played an NCAA tournament, with a program that's had big expectations and won a lot of games the last 2-3 years. Also is low post presence. And so, you know, combined with Bannon, I think offensively there'll be a level of improvement there. And then along with him is Lalu Oki, who led the country in rebound at Division II level. So I think that our front line has gotten a big boost just from those two guys.
When you look at kind of the systems you guys implement both on offense and defense, and when you have more size, do you notice many differences kind of when you have kind of some of those versatilities as opposed to, you know, maybe smaller athletes, but you actually have kind of some size in the paint? You notice any difference?
When the size is versatile, you know, 17, 18 with Jamar and Fab, those guys were mobile. They weren't necessarily, you know, 6'9", 6'10". They were 6'7", and mobile, but strong enough to hold their spot against bigger guys. And that's always been important to us because of the style we play defensively. I think that Lalu and Deshaun can present some of those same things.
Absolutely. And coupled with them, obviously, you bring back a really strong core from last year's team as well. You know, you have your Brandon Whitney, Josh Bannon, Mac Anderson guys, but, you know, Vasquez and Lonnell Martin as well. Just, you know, what have you liked to see from those guys when you bring a good core group back and, right, you know, kind of implement these other guys on the team?
Well, it's always important to return multiple guys that understand how we do things, what's important on both sides of the ball, and then have a high level of intensity and also understand how to communicate the way we communicate on and off the court. And that's where your culture is based from. And I think that those guys that are returning are guys that are very positive in that manner and will help this team come cohesive in a very timely manner.
Whitney and Bannon are these guys who were kind of thrown right into the fire as freshmen during the COVID season. And last year, just you could just see them keep making steps and getting better and better and better. So when you look at those two specifically as kind of some of the leaders of this team, what are maybe some of your expectations for them as they kind of go forward in their junior year?
Always big expectations for juniors that have a lot of playing experience. Those guys as freshmen and sophomores played a lot of minutes, and they were able to grow through those. And some of it was a roller coaster ride. There were nights where they weren't their best, but when they were, you could see what their potential was. And so I think we went and added the right pieces that fit with what we turned. And now it's all about just creating chemistry and a style of play that's conducive to everybody being successful.
It was interesting last year because the Big Sky Conference as a whole was very old. And, you know, we talked about this off camera a little bit, how, you know, just a lot of experience coming back because of the COVID year, all these guys getting extra eligibility. So what's kind of your analysis of the league this year as it might be a little bit similar but a few more stars this season?
Well, I think the high expectation going to come from the teams with the most experience again. But when you return guys like Bello at Montana State, Kuntz at Northern Colorado, those are guys that can have big expectations because either one was all conference and player of the year on both sides of the ball, and then another led the conference in scoring. So they're going to come with a high level of expectation and even some national exposure in terms of opportunity to play for some things down the stretch of the year. But there's other teams. Weber, you know, returns quite a bit of experience and brought in some transfers that will have some high expectation. And then there's the unknowns at places like Sac State. So once again, our conference is going to be talented top to bottom, and anyone can win on any given night. But I think the teams like Montana State and Northern Colorado are going to come in with the highest amount of expectations.
When you look at your non-conference schedule, this is kind of one of these opportunities each year. You guys kind of, you know, see a little bit who you guys are. You test yourselves against some of these programs.
Right.
Obviously, I believe you're at Air Force this year. You're at Gonzaga. You're going to get a couple of these big games, get some home games as well. You know, what do you like about your non-conference schedule and how that's going to kind of test you guys heading into the conference season?
As usual, we hit the road two games early at Duquesne and Xavier, played a high level. Go East, where style of basketball is a lot more physical, a lot different than what we experience on the West. And so we'll learn a lot about ourselves on that first initial road trip and then come home and host a tournament, which for me, I feel like is an opportunity to kind of prepare for what March feels like, trying to win three in 3 nights. And then you kind of test the waters with some like opponents on the road at home and close it out with a team like Gonzaga on the road. So we'll learn a lot about ourselves. We'll get a lot of experience early. And hopefully we can walk away from some of these games with quite a few wins and some high expectations going into conference.
It's wild because, Travis, I believe this is your ninth year coaching the Montana Grizzlies this year, your alma mater. You know, when you look at, you know, some of the things you accomplished last year, some coaching milestones and, you know, some of the things you've accomplished in your career at Montana, what maybe stands out and what makes you the most excited about year nine here at Montana?
I think off the court is what we are the most excited about at the end of every season, right? The graduation rates. The guys that move on and have success after they take off that Grizzly uniform. And so for me, it's always enjoy them while you have them. Convince them to enjoy the process and the moment while they have it. I think this is a team that can compete for a championship. I think this is a group that when we come together cohesively can create a high level of expectation for themselves. But at the same time, I'm more excited about the daily routines, you know, the film sessions, the one-on-one conversations in the office, the text messages at night, and then creating a level of expectation. Right now, we don't know what to expect from this group. And so we're a month or two away from really having a true feel for who we are and what we can accomplish. And sometimes that's the fun part, is creating that level of expectation while you're going out and competing together. And so I look forward to that first opportunity.
I do as well. Should be a fun season. Looking forward to things kicking off here pretty soon for you guys as well. Travis, thanks so much for your time and joining us here. And don't go anywhere. We'll be rejoined by head coach Bobby Houck to look ahead to the Montana football game against Weber State this Saturday.
Take coverage of the Grizz with you. Download our app for your favorite mobile device today. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, and we are rejoined by head coach Bobby Houck. Just like last week we talked, Bobby, it's on to the next one, right? That's kind of how the mentality has to be.
Yeah, that's what you have to do. You can't, as much as we'd like to sit and dwell on that last one a little bit and rehash it some more, you and I have probably done enough of that, and I got to get to work and get on to Weber State, which we're going to talk about a little bit here.
Absolutely. You know, Weber State, it's another gauntlet test for you guys. Obviously, you guys are one of the best teams in the conference, and it feels like you're hitting every other team in the conference that's right up there as well. So, you know, what do you know about Jay Hill's squad and what they got going down there in Ogden?
Well, going into last week's game, in the upcoming weeks, we had three of the top five in America on the road, which is no one else has to do that in the league. That's our schedule. That's what it is. Weber's awfully good. They'll be tough, detailed, well-coached. They'll be solid in all three phases of the game. Just probably a complete team. I have a lot of respect for how they do things. Should be a heck of a game. I think they probably two-degree feel the same way about us. That would be for them to say, but I think it'll be a heck of a good football game down there.
You guys saw them twice in 2019, but haven't seen them since. So when you look at this year's team, like, do they look at all different, or because they know Jay Hill's been there so long, is it kind of, you typically know for the most part what you're getting out of the Wildcats?
They're like us. They are who they are. I mean, they'll adapt and change some things. They're well coached. And Brent Myers, their offensive line coach, has coached for 100 years, and I've worked with him at numerous places. He does a great job. They'll be good in the kicking game. All those things that they do, that they hang their hat on, they'll be good at a lot of things.
Feels like Weber State, when you typically see a team like them, complete is kind of the word. Kind of similar to you guys, right? You know, they're always very sound on offense and defense. Is that how you typically noticed Weber in the past? Is they're just, you know, sound really in all phases of the game?
That's exactly it. A to Z, they'll do things right. They'll be detailed. They'll be organized. They'll be tough. Hopefully we see some of those things and we look in the mirror, as you mentioned, which makes you hard to beat. Should be two good football teams going at it. The last time, as you mentioned, we played in 2019, we played twice in a span of 3 weeks or three games, and those were great games. We won one going away here in Missoula, and then really similar to last night's game, found a way not to get the one done in Ogden in the quarterfinals. Should be a heck of a game.
Ultimately, it is all about forward motion, and you know there's still a lot of season left to be played, a lot of opportunities for your guys to still go forward. Obviously, the Sac State game stings, but is that really just the message to these guys is, hey, there's still four games left. There's a lot that can still be determined this season.
That the Sac State game stings. You're on the Hornet metaphor, yeah.
You got it.
Yeah, it stings. We're not right where we want to be right now, but that's life. You react to your situation, you react to adversity, and you know, we need to move forward positively and go get it. We don't want to be 5-2 right now. We want to be 7-0. It's not where we are. So we get to charge forward and see what we can do with this week.
As always, Coach, thanks so much for your time.
All right, thanks.
Appreciate you on the show. And don't go anywhere. We'll be right back here on Grizzly Insider.
Welcome Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Thanks so much for tuning into this week's Grizzly Insider here on MTN. We'll see you back here next week to break down Montana's matchup with Weber State, and we'll also be joined by Lady Grizz head coach Brian Holsinger to preview their upcoming basketball season. Have a great evening.
MTN Sports. This is Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to MTN's Grizzly Insider. I'm your host, Kyle Hansen. This past weekend saw the Montana Grizzlies go to Sacramento, California for a top 10 matchup with Sac State. And we'll be joined by Grizz head coach Bobby Houck to talk about that game, as well as look ahead to UM's upcoming game with Weber State. We'll also be joined by Grizz men's basketball coach Travis DeKeer to preview the upcoming season for Montana, a team with high expectations as basketball season is right around the corner. All of that is coming up, but we'll kick things off looking back at the highlights from Montana's contest with Sacramento State. The Montana Grizzlies entered the game number 7 in the FCS, but lost to Idaho last week and had lost two straight contests to the Hornets, a team ranked number 2 in the country. The game started off well for the Grizz, who used a 15-play drive to score the game's first points, as they became the first team this year to lead Sac State. But disaster and controversy struck in the second quarter, as UM quarterback Lucas Johnson was injured on a late-hit targeting foul that took him out of the game. So Chris Brown entered the game at QB, and Montana held onto the lead as UM's defense forced a pair of turnovers in the second quarter to throw Sac State's league-leading offense off balance. Now down 10-0, Sac State found its way onto the board as Jake Dunaway found Marshall Martin for a 38-yard touchdown. Nico Ramos went 1-for-3 on field goals in the first half, including a blocked kick right before halftime, but UM still led 10-7. Montana's defense continued to play lights out as Nash Fouch picks off Dunaway for Montana's second interception of the game. Then later, Brown hit Aaron Fonts for a 16-yard touchdown, and just like that, Montana led 17-7. However, Sac State scored on the first play of the fourth quarter when Dunaway hit Pierre Williams to trim it to 17-14. But UM racked up 200 yards rushing, led mostly by Marcus Knight and Nick Osmo. And here's Osmo capping another long UM drive to make it 24-14 Grizz. Sac State got a break on another UM special team snafu as the kick bounced off of Tyler Flink and the Hornets recovered. Following that recovery, Sac State faced a 4th-and-4 on UM's 30, and it was arguably the most talked about play from the game, as Dunaway finds Jared Gibson along the sideline and it's ruled a catch, but it appears Gibson's foot is out of bounds before the catch was made. However, it's reviewed and confirmed by officials, and on the very next play, Asher O'Hara tied it 24-24. The game would go into overtime after neither team could score on their final drives of regulation. But the Hornets needed just 4 plays before O'Hara found the end zone again. Meanwhile, UM went 4 and out as the Hornets held on for their 3rd straight victory over the Grizz, 31-24. Up next, we have Grizz head coach Bobby Houck in studio to break down Montana's game against the Hornets. We'll be right back on Grizzly Insider.
There's more coverage of the Grizzlies online anytime at montanasports.com. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, and we're both kind of, you know, operating on a couple hours of sleep here with head coach Bobby Houck. Bobby, how are you feeling? And, you know, just coming off another tough loss for you guys.
Yeah, you know, coming off of that game last night wasn't all that much fun in terms of the outcome. The game being played was enjoyable to be a part of, but 2 hours of sleep's not good for either one of us.
Right. I was about to say, coming off a long road trip, we're back here. But we're back here to, you know, chop it up a little bit about this game. And, you know, that you've had, not a ton of time to digest this one. Just kind of, you know, give me some of your thoughts of that you've got to think about it a little bit.
Well, yeah, we've had a couple hours to think about it. And I'm really disappointed. I thought our team played really well in the game. I thought they played hard and physical. I thought that our assistant coaches had a nice game plan. We executed it really well. You know, we're sitting here, we lost a week ago to a pretty good Idaho team, and then we went on the road and lost to the second-ranked team in America in a game that, you know, we really feel like we should have won. So that's disappointing, but there's some positives we can take out of it when we're moving forward this week.
You guys started the game so strong in that first offensive drive. I think it was about a six-minute drive. You know, Lucas Johnson looks really good throwing the ball. He runs it a couple times, and you guys cap it off with the touchdown run to make it 7-0. First time Sac State has trailed all season long. And then, you know, later in the game, Lucas gets the targeting hit on him on the late hit, knocks him out of the game. Just, you know, my first question, I guess, is what did you like about your offense, the way you guys are running? And then, you know, when he goes out, how much did that kind of change things?
Well, I liked the way it was going. Lucas was playing great. Sac State had not even begun to think about stopping us at that point, I don't think. We were rolling up and down the field. And then, you know, you're never going to be real excited when your starting quarterback or any of your players gets knocked out on a late hit and a targeting foul. So that was a bad play. I was pleased with Chris Brown coming in and taking the reins and helping us score some points and keep the lead through the game.
It's such a pivotal play when he goes out and things like that. So as you guys, you know, are kind of on the fly adjusting, I guess, what is that process like? And obviously your thoughts probably go to him too, because it was a pretty scary play.
Yeah, first concerns for our guy. But we have a good medical staff, and they took good care of him, of course. Disappointed he was unable to return, certainly, because he was playing so well and the offense was rolling. But you prepare for that. There's a reason why that guy's the starter. So you prepare for it, and you temper your call sheet as best you can, but you got to go operate. And I thought our kids rose to the occasion. I was fired up about our players. The attitude's awesome. I just really like this team and how they approach things.
You, like you kind of touched on, Chris Brown played well in relief. You know, obviously you had some experience with that last year coming in and playing. You know, just what'd you like about the way he kind of helped run the offense? And, you know, really as the game progressed, they couldn't stop you guys running, and you guys really could control it on offense, it seemed like.
My sense is that the offensive line is really evolving and getting better. They're pretty young, but that's the best it's looked in maybe 4 years. So in terms of being able to kind of impose our will and run the ball the way we want to run it, those guys did a nice job. Our running backs ran hard. We were productive. We were good on defense. You know, again, we led the whole game. So it's really disappointing not to be able to close it out.
Last week against Idaho was interesting because, you know, the last couple of weeks, they've talked about the turnover battle and how you guys have kind of been on the tough end of that. But, I mean, your guys played so well. Corbin Walker had the interception in the second, Nash the interception in the third, and, you know, just kind of helped you guys keep that momentum, you know, in that element. So, you know, the defense coming up with big plays like that, what was like seeing that from them? Because, they seemed like they play really, really well.
We had we have smart guys in our defense, and we really kind of had two different game plans. For the two different quarterbacks they use, because the offenses are a little bit different and based on who's in the game. And I thought our defense gave them some things that they hadn't handled and hadn't seen. Had them confused a little bit, harassed them into some bad plays. So it was a good job. Just like I said, game like that, you know, you need one more play. I mean, literally one more play in any phase, and we get the job done there. And it's unfortunate we didn't. Pretty disappointed in that.
It's a game that ultimately came down to just some tough breaks, you know, whether it be some injuries, you know, some things that maybe didn't go your guys' way, you know, just in a game like that, you know, how do you, I guess, like, you know, what's it like being in that moment trying to kind of, you know, steer the ship forward when it just felt like everything was kind of going against you guys, against them?
Well, that's well said. Probably the way I should say it. Yeah, everything was working against us, certainly, late in the game, in particular in the fourth quarter. Our guys were composed. Everything that could go against us went against us. There are some things in the game that I think were, I don't know, probably not good enough by a lot of folks. So we need to finish it out.
Ultimately, too, get to the overtime period. Sac ultimately does tie it, and you know, just what was kind of the message to the team then, and what were you guys kind of looking for on your offensive possession towards the end there?
Well, it's kind of like any point in the game. You go play the next play. You know, football games, there's going to be momentum swings, and it's going to go up and down and back and forth, especially when two good teams are playing. And so, you know, that's what it is. Go play the next play. You can't worry about the last one. You got to play the next play. Sometimes you don't do well, and you've got to go make a play on the next one. And that's part of being a competitor and closing games out.
Well, thanks so much, Coach. Yeah. Don't go anywhere right now. Coach will rejoin us here to look ahead to Weber State. We'll also be joined by head men's basketball coach Travis Tahir to preview the upcoming basketball season for the Montana Grizzlies.
Get social with Grizzly fans and follow MTN Sports on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider. And folks, basketball season is just about here, and I am joined by head men's basketball coach Travis DeKeer to talk about the upcoming season for the Montana Grizzlies. Travis, it's great to see you.
Appreciate you having me.
Of course. I mean, hard to believe, basketball season, couple weeks away. You know, a lot of excitement around your team coming into this season. You want to just kind of walk us through what this year's Grizzly squad is going to look like for you guys?
Bigger, faster, stronger. For us, really, it was addressing some of our weaknesses, rebounding, defending in the paint. So we went out and got some size and added some athleticism, but more importantly, experience.
It's interesting, too, you know, bigger, stronger, you know, as I've been covering this team for about 5 years now, and by far this is the biggest team I think I've seen in my time here, watching you guys play. You know, just walk us through maybe some of these transfers that you brought in. You brought in, you know, a very skilled player in Deshaun Thomas from Colorado State. He's going to add a lot, and some of these other guys, you know, just kind of talk about what you've seen from them for your first few months of practice with these guys.
Yeah, versatility offensively from Deshaun I think is the biggest thing. You know, he's known for a three-point shooting. Obviously, that was his role at Colorado State. But as a young man that's played in the NCAA tournament, with a program that's had big expectations and won a lot of games the last 2-3 years, also is low post presence. And so, you know, combined with Bannon, I think offensively there'll be a level of improvement there. And then along with him is Lalu Okeh, who led the country in rebound at the Division II level. So I think that our front line has gotten a big boost just from those two guys.
When you look at kind of the systems you guys implement both on offense and defense, and when you have more size, do you notice many differences kind of when you have kind of some of those versatilities as opposed to, you know, maybe smaller athletes, but you actually have kind of some size in the paint? You notice any difference?
When the size is versatile, you know, 17, 18 with Jamar and Fab, those guys were mobile. They weren't necessarily, you know, 6'9", 6'10". They're 6'7", and mobile. But strong enough to hold their spot against bigger guys. And that's always been important to us because of the style we play defensively. I think that Lalu and Deshaun can present some of those same things.
Absolutely. And coupled with them, obviously, you bring back a really strong core from last year's team as well. You know, you have your Brandon Whitney, Josh Bannon, Mac Anderson guys, but, you know, Vasquez and Lonnell Martin as well. Just, you know, what have you liked to see from those guys when you bring a good core group back and, right, you know, kind of implement these other guys on the team?
Well, it's always important to return multiple guys that understand how we do things, what's important on both sides of the ball, and then have a high level of intensity and also understand how to communicate the way we communicate on and off the court. And that's where your culture is based from. And I think that those guys that are returning are guys that are very positive in that manner and will help this team come cohesive in a very timely manner.
Whitney and Bannon are these guys who were kind of thrown right into the fire as freshmen during the COVID season. And last year, just you could just see them keep making steps and getting better and better and better. So when you look at those two specifically as kind of some of the leaders of this team, what are maybe some of your expectations for them as they kind of go forward in their junior year?
Always big expectations for juniors that have a lot of playing experience. Those guys as freshmen and sophomores played a lot of minutes, and they were able to grow through those. And some of it was a roller coaster ride. There were nights where they weren't their best, but when they were, you could see what their potential was. And so I think we went and added the right pieces that fit with what we turned. And now it's all about just creating chemistry and a style of play that's conducive to everybody being successful.
It was interesting last year because the Big Sky Conference as a whole was very old. And, you know, we talked about this off camera a little bit, how, you know, just a lot of experience coming back because of the COVID year, all these guys getting extra eligibility. So what's kind of your analysis of the league this year, as it might be a little bit similar but a few more stars this season?
Well, I think the high expectation are going to come from the teams with the most experience again. But when you return guys like Bello at Montana State, Kuntz at Northern Colorado, those are guys that can have big expectations because either one was all conference and player of the year on both sides of the ball, and then another led the conference in scoring. So they're going to come with a high level of expectation and even some national exposure in terms of opportunity to play for some things down the stretch of the year. But there's other teams. Weber, you know, returns quite a bit of experience and brought in some transfers that will have some high expectation. And then there's the unknowns at places like Sac State. So once again, our conference is going to be talented top to bottom, and anyone can win on any given night. But I think the teams like Montana State and Northern Colorado are going to come in with the highest amount of expectations.
When you look at your non-conference schedule, this is kind of one of these opportunities each year. You guys kind of, you know, see a little bit who you guys are. You test yourselves against some of these programs.
Right.
Obviously, I believe you're at Air Force this year. You're at Gonzaga. You're going to get a couple of these big games, get some home games as well. You know, what do you like about your non-conference schedule and how that's going to kind of test you guys heading into the conference season?
As usual, we hit the road 2 games early at Duquesne and Xavier, played at a high level. Go East, where style of basketball is a lot more physical, a lot different than what we experience on the West. And so we'll learn a lot about ourselves on that first initial road trip and then come home and host a tournament, which for me, I feel like is an opportunity to kind of prepare for what March feels like, trying to win three in 3 nights. And then you kind of test the waters with some like opponents on the road at home and close it out with the team like Gonzaga on the road. So we'll learn a lot about ourselves. We'll get a lot of experience early. And hopefully we can walk away from some of these games with quite a few wins and some high expectations going into conference.
It's wild because, Travis, I believe this is your 9th year coaching the Montana Grizzlies this year, your alma mater. When you look at, some of the things you accomplished last year, some coaching milestones and, some of the things you've accomplished in your career at Montana, what maybe stands out and what makes you the most excited about year 9 here at Montana?
I think off the court is what we are the most excited about at the end of every season, right? The graduation rates. The guys that move on and have success after they take off that Grizzly uniform. And so for me, it's always enjoy them while you have them, convince them to enjoy the process and the moment while they have it. I think this is a team that can compete for a championship. I think this is a group that when we come together cohesively can create a high level of expectation for themselves. But at the same time, I'm more excited about the daily routines, the film sessions, the one-on-one conversations in the office, the text messages at night, and then creating a level of expectation. Right now, we don't know what to expect from this group, and so we're a month or two away from really having a true feel for who we are and what we can accomplish, and sometimes that's the fun part, is creating that level of expectation while you're going out and competing together, and so I look forward to that first opportunity.
I do as well. Should be a fun season. Looking forward to things kicking off here pretty soon for you guys as well. Travis, thanks so much for your time and joining us here. And don't go anywhere. We'll be rejoined by head coach Bobby Houck to look ahead to the Montana football game against Weber State this Saturday.
Take coverage of the Grizz with you. Download our app for your favorite mobile device today. Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, and we are rejoined by head coach Bobby Houck. Just like last week we talked, Bobby, it's on to the next one, right? That's kind of how the mentality has to be.
Yeah, that's what you have to do. You can't, as much as we'd like to sit and dwell on that last one a little bit, and rehash it some more. You and I have probably done enough of that, and I got to get to work and get on to Weber State, which we're going to talk about a little bit here.
Absolutely. Weber State, it's another gauntlet test for you guys. Obviously, you guys are one of the best teams in the conference, and it feels like you're hitting every other team in the conference that's right up there as well. So, what do you know about Jay Hill's squad and what they got going down there in Ogden?
Well, going into last week's game, in the upcoming weeks, we had 3 of the top 5 in America on the road, which is no one else has to do that in the league. That's our schedule. That's what it is. Weber's awfully good. They'll be tough, detailed, well-coached. They'll be solid in all 3 phases of the game. Just probably a complete team. I have a lot of respect for how they do things. Should be a heck of a game. I think they probably, to a degree, feel the same way about us. That would be for them to say, but I think it'll be a heck of a good football game down there.
You guys saw them twice in 2019, but haven't seen them since. So when you look at this year's team, like, do they look at all different, or because they know Jay Hill's been there so long, is it kind of, you typically know for the most part what you're getting out of the Wildcats?
They're like us. They are who they are. I mean, they'll adapt and change some things. They're well coached. Brent Myers, their offensive line coach, has coached for 100 years, and I've worked with him at numerous places. He does a great job. They'll be good in the kicking game. All those things that they do, that they hang their hat on, they'll be good at a lot of things.
Feels like Weber State, when you typically see a team like them, complete is kind of the word. Kind of similar to you guys, right? They're always very sound on offense and defense. Is that how you've typically noticed Weber in the past? Is they're just, sound really in all phases of the game?
That's exactly it. A to Z, they'll do things right. They'll be detailed. They'll be organized. They'll be tough. Hopefully we see some of those things and we look in the mirror, as you mentioned, which makes you hard to beat. Should be 2 good football teams going at it. The last time, as you mentioned, we played in 2019, we played twice in a span of 3 weeks or 3 games, and those were great games. We won one going away here in Missoula, and then really similar to last night's game, found a way not to get the one done in Ogden in the quarterfinals. Should be a heck of a game.
Ultimately, it is all about forward motion, and there's still a lot of season left to be played, a lot of opportunities for your guys to still go forward. Obviously, the Sac State game stings, but is that really just the message to these guys is, hey, there's still 4 games left. There's a lot that can still be determined this season.
The Sac State game stings. You're on the Hornet metaphor, yeah.
You got it.
Yeah, it stings. We're not right where we want to be right now, but that's life. You react to your situation, you react to adversity, and you know, we need to move forward positively and go get it. We don't want to be 5-2 right now. We want to be 7-0. It's not where we are. So we get to charge forward and see what we can do with this week.
As always, Coach, thanks so much for your time.
All right, thanks.
Appreciate you on the show. And don't go anywhere. We'll be right back here on Grizzly Insider.
Welcome back to Grizzly Insider, sponsored by Albertson Safeway.
Thanks so much for tuning into this week's Grizzly Insider here on MTN. We'll see you back here next week to break down Montana's matchup with Weber State, and we'll also be joined by Lady Grizz head coach Brian Holsinger to preview their upcoming basketball season. Have a great evening.